Something to save him. You failed. He was my friend.
Thank you. that lavender soothes and brings sleep, and thyme heals wounds, and rosemary helps you remember how you got them. But they're wrong. There's no herb for forgiveness. And if there was, it would be very bitter. The gypsies sing and dance and drink to expel their demons. But I've never been much of a dancer. And we shouldn't forget those first ones back then. The sounds of those women's voices screaming to have their children be allowed to die with them rather than hand them over to his men. This is his legacy. The death of thousands of children who were stolen away, and starting with these Republican women whose children were torn from their breasts, and then these women were taken outside and shot. And the children handed over to those more deserving. So it begins. Back off the devil's backbone, and I just want to take him home, Lord. I just want to take him home. Oh Lord, oh Lord, what have I done? I'm falling in love with a man on the run. Oh Lord, oh Lord, I'm begging you, please don't take that sinner from me. Don't take that sinner from me. Oh Lord, oh Lord, what do I do? I'm falling for someone who's nothing like you. He's raised on the edge of the devil's backbone. Oh, I just wanna take him home. Oh, I just wanna take him home.
I was 17. I know it sounds so stupid, but I didn't even realize I was pregnant. It was my mother that mentioned, well, that I had put on some weight. They wanted to throw me out, but our priest said there was somewhere I could have the baby and I would be looked after. No one asked me what I thought about anything. I had no voice. My mom cried for days, and my father wouldn't speak to me, and I just wanted to run away. But I had nowhere to go, and in 1964, you couldn't be on your own with a child. I suppose, deep down, I knew they were going to take the baby away, but no one mentioned. I remember hearing my mother and father talking about how I brought shame on the family, that I let them down, and I remember praying on my knees, praying to the Holy Mother that it couldn't just go away. And all the time my baby was kicking inside of me, as if it knew. When the time came, my dad took me to the hospital. He didn't speak to me in the car, and he just drove me off with my bag, and one of the nuns came out. She was very old and didn't smile. I just felt so ashamed, and I tried really hard not to cry because I didn't want her to know I was scared. She took me to my room, which was tiny, with one chair and a bed. And when she left, I did cry, and I begged. I begged God to take my sin away, but he didn't. They couldn't let us wear our own night clothes. We had cotton nighties, which were very old. Mine had a brown stain on the back, and I kept imagining it was blood from the girl who's born it before me. You had to be examined when you arrived, and the doctor couldn't look at you or speak to you. He just addressed the nun. It was as if you didn't exist. I'd never been examined before down there, and he hurt me, and I remember thinking I deserved to be hurt, and closing my eyes because I could see myself reflecting his glasses, and felt so guilty and ashamed. My waters broke at 4 o'clock in the morning. I didn't know what was happening. I was getting terrible pains and was screaming for help. One of the sisters came in and smacked me hard on my arm. She told me I was selfish and to shut up because everyone was in bed. I tried really hard not to make a fuss, but there was no pain relief. I suppose it was part of the punishment. It went on for hours. After she was born, they gave me some gas when I went to sleep. And when I woke up, the doctor came in and told me my baby had died. That there was something wrong with her, and she was stillborn. I remember asking to see her. It didn't seem real. I think they just wanted me to shut up. So he told one of the nurses to fetch her so I could say goodbye. But when they brought the baby to show me, she was so cold and her eyes were wide open, staring. And I remember screaming, she wasn't dead. And they put the mask over my face, and I don't remember much after that. When I came home, it was as if nothing had happened. No one ever spoke about it. It was as if she never existed. But my baby was alive. I don't care what they say, because I saw her. When they delivered her, she was moving. She was not dead. I could see her little legs kicking, reflecting in the doctor's steel rimmed glasses. I saw her. Before I closed my eyes, she was alive, and I will never forget her. Never.
And the years passed, and the gypsies kept dancing, and the rosemary kept growing, and a whole generation of children lost their heritage, just like you wanted.
Yeah. Do you remember the day he died? Father.
I remember the day I ran away. I remember the day I ran away and left her crying when all the time he was asking me to save him. She was like a child then, disbelieving, and all the time he was asking me not to let him die. And you were right then, in that minute you were right. All those times you said I wasn't good enough, you were right. I lived up to your expectations.
You always do.
Ah, they were so low. I was afraid. That's why I ran. I was afraid of looking into his dying eyes and knowing I couldn't save him, I couldn't save myself. I've seen disappointment again. That's why I ran, and I'm sorry.
Oh, poor you. You let them down, Maria, didn't you?
I did everything I could. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I'm not your flesh and blood. I'm sorry I couldn't save him. I tried. I tried to be like you, and I wasn't good enough. I wasn't good enough.
Yeah.
Not then. Not now. Never. That's why I ran.